pedig Hájló Gábor Varsató, a Baja Observatory of Humidity of Szeged, and I did today the light curve modeling of eclipsing binary stars, the new features that was given this year. The stars, a lot of stars were brightness varying because of physical variation, or only we can see that the light is changing. Sometimes the stars are pulsating, is growing and contracting. They are pulsating stars, but sometimes we measure light variation only because one star eclipses another one, or these are the binary stars. Binary stars could be visual binaries, then we see two stars only for coincidence in the same direction, but they are, can be from each other more light years, more thousand light years or so. But the normal binary stars, they are close to other, or they are gravitationally bound. We are studying these stars, and the more of the half of the stars are in binary systems or in multiple systems. So in that case, our Sun is a very rare star because it's alone. The other stars like companionships. But okay, so then two stars are orbiting in the center of mass of the system, as I mentioned before. One star can eclipse the other one, and usually one star is fainter, brighter, and the other one is fainter. And if a star eclipses another star, there will be minima in the light curve. The light curve is the brightness of the star in the function of the time. And we can, for the different systems, we get different light curves. The stars can be far from each other or can close to each other. There are better systems when the stars are almost quite, the distance is quite big from them. There we get maxima is quite constant, and there is a big gap, is a primary minima, and a little depression is the secondary minima. If the stars are close to each other, it can be contact or over contact binaries. The stars are filling the Roche lobes. This is the equipotential surface where the two stars' gravitational force is the same, so here can matter transfer from between the stars. In that case, we can see that the light curves are much, it's not the same. It differs from the detached stars. And if it could be that the one star feels only the Roche lobes, or didn't feel the Roche lobe, but for the tidal forces, the surface is not spherical. In that case, we can have ellipsoidal variables that are very different light curves we can measure. So how, what affects the light curves? Affects the orbit in the first place. The very the orbits parameters are very big, has a big effect. If the orbit are circular or eccentric, distances is close or detached, or how we can see the system. If we can see the system on the edge, we saw almost every case eclipses. If we see the system perpendicular to the orbital plane, we don't see eclipses. But if the stars are close to each other in the contact or over contact binaries, we can see eclipses with bigger inclinations too. Okay, and how can we detect these or observe these life curves? From ground-based observations, our group works also observations from the Piszkeset Observatory in the Vátra Mountains at the Academy of Hungary Academy of Sciences, from the Gotthard Observatory of Erdély University in Szombathely, and from the Baja Observatory of the Szeged University from Baja. From these places we mostly use not light curves, but radial velocity light curves. It's a different. You can get these curves from spectroscopy. Made other data for us. But now I am concentrating on the light curves. We get a lot of light curves from space missions like Gaia. During its 5 years operational periods, Gaia will give us petabytes of data, so a lot of data will reach us, and it's very hard to analyze all of these data. But for the Gaia, not for the binaries, is its main goal. Astrometry is the main goal of Gaia, but we'll observe binaries also. Sure. But Kepler and Corot, it's older missions, but they have a lot of binary light curves from these missions. From Kepler and Corot, I think we'll talk much János and Tamás after my presentation. So, the problem with these light curves is that there are a lot of light curves and a lot of binary system or a multiple system in our galaxy, and we get a lot of data, and it's not so easy to interpret these light curves. So we have to get some modeling and analysis, and we have to do a lot of times. From Kepler we get more, some thousands light curves, I think, or more. So it's a bit quite time-consuming task. So it requires some automatization and parallelizing. The oldest or the most respected binary code is the FIBI, Wilson Bilini code. Now have more are better, but they are based about that code. But it only works with binaries. We would like to work with multiple systems and exoplanet systems also. And we would like to parallelize our code on first mainly on GPU, because calculate a light curve on CPU, it can take some minutes. And if you would like to get the orbital and the stellar parameters from the light curve, we would do the inverse problem. We have to run the light curve code many thousand times, so it could be days when we get the parameters of the binary system from the light curve. So we would like to get a faster code on GPU. Our group's aim is complex analysis of today's and future space photometry of multiple stellar and planetary systems. Our PI, Dr. Tamás Borkovics from the Szeged University of Baja Observatorium, and the members are Emese Forgászlajtos from the University of Erte, and János Takocs and Tamás Hajdú will be after me. So now what we have is the C code of Tamás Borkovics that can, it's able to model binary, triple, and hierarchical triple stellar system, E, and two gravitationally bound binary systems. When there are, we get two binaries that are gravitationally bound to each other, so there are four stars, but the two one are closer to each other, and these binaries are separated from each other. So, and we, now we would like to have done some parts to refine this code, and the main aim is to accelerate the computation by using by GPU parallelization. And I am doing this GPU parallelization. Tamás is evolving and other parts of the code. So why it is useful to this GPU, why it will be useful to us? Because there are a lot of parameters of our model. There are orbital parameters, stellar parameters. These are very not too funny. It could be even 20 or 30 parameters. And the running of the code of the CPU is takes a lot of minutes or hours for a one star if you want to get the parameters on the light curve. If you want to calculate the light curve from the parameters, it could be some seconds or minutes, but if you want the other direction, we use the Markov chain Monte Carlo method to determine the parameters, it could be hours or days on the CPU. Okay, I will show you to use some orbital parameters, and there is a picture. Oh, we are studying the eclipses on the plane of the sky. The plane of the sky is perpendicular to our line of sight, and the inclination is the angle of this plane and the orbital plane. We are calculating the star's positions in the orbital plane using the Kepler equation in the binary case. This part of the code is on the CPU because it isn't too efficient to transfer to the GPU. From the CPU, first we get for the time for different times the positions of the stars. The primary star is always in the center of our coordinate system. The second, the x-axis of the system always direct to the secondary star. This is a co-rotating system we using. So first we calculate the star's positions on the orbital plane in our co-rotational system. It is on the CPU. And we calculate the surface grid of each star on CPU also. And this data we are copying to the GPU, the device, and there we will calculate all of the parameters of the grid points on the stellar surface. This part is parallelized on our code because we have a lot of surface grid points on each star, and we have to calculate the same bit for each grid points, and these don't depend from each other, so we can easily parallelize this part of our code. Only one point will be we have to change our philosophy when we are calculating the reflection between the two stars. In that case, we have to calculate parallel simultaneously all of the stars and all of the surface grids. So this could be done only on the CPU. So okay, it's the other picture from the same. I will go faster. Okay, so for the surface element or a grid point on the stellar surface, we should calculate the brightness or the emitted flux of a surface element. It can be easily estimated based on the Stefan Boltzmann law, but we can use the Kurutz atmospheric model for this part. And this is a little picture of our code. It can it can do the same thing, almost the same thing on a CPU or on GPU, because sometimes we would like to verify our results we get from the GPU, it would be verified on the CPU. So if we can calculate the stellar radii and stellar surface parameters like the coordinates on the plane of sky and the temperature, gravitational acceleration and so on the surfaces on the CPU, and using the shared block memory we summing these elements brightness, and we get the stellar brightness, so we can calculate our part. I will a bit faster because I have only 2 minutes, I think. So this is our surface grid. It's an example from before. These stars are detached stars because are spherical and they are not rotating fastly, because if they are rotating, there couldn't be if they rotating fastly, they couldn't be spherical. It was the first very, the most simple example of us. And we get this light curve on CPU and GPU also. There is a primary and a secondary minima, which is on the primary in a bigger part. But we now, if the two stars are close to each other, a contact or over contact stars, we can calculate the changing of the shape of the star because of the tidal forces. It will be that it is far from spherical. We could get this dimensionless gravitational potential. We can calculate we have to calculate the radii for every cell because it will be different because the gravitational forces, and in that case we're using to calculate the surface radii the Newton-Raphson or and Brand's MET method. It should be done for each cell, so it should be done on the GPU. It's not so effective on the GPU. It will be a bit our code will be take a bit longer. I will show you this parts. This is our stars now. It looks like that it's far from spherical. In that case, it's rotating. Okay, and you get the light curve is very different from the detached star. Okay, the most important part, or how fast it could be on GPU. I tested this on my computer. The number one refers to my computer on the university. The second one is a computer in the GPU labor of Wigner Research Center. It can be seen that the CPU is a little bit harder on my computer, but the GPU is much better on the Wigner Center. We have a different grids, because in the theta direction we have 40 or 60 grid points. In the sum of the surface elements it could be 1,300 and 3,000. And here, okay, so with the lower resolution it's enough. It could be 20 for the ground-based observations. And I will show that we get not so much in the GPU in that case, but if it has a fine resolution, the GPU will be much faster. But the Kepler data, it's very fine data from the Kepler mission, and we need the final resolution for Kepler data. So studying Kepler data, we need this better final resolution, and here will be the times for this. If here we using the Roche model, here spherical stars, so we didn't have a Roche model. It can be seen that with Roche model we have a bit longer computational time for to run. And it can be seen that the CPU is, if the grid points are 40 in one direction, it's more than 10 times faster. But if we have 60, it's almost 50 times faster on the GPU. This graph shows better. These two are on CPU with Newton Raphson's, the CPU without it, the other CPU with the Roche model, another one without it, and these are the GPU. So it's, and in the, when we have the 60 grid points in the better direction, it's much faster. So you can see we get a lot of time using GPU in that case. So it's nice. So now our code uses this binary as in the Roche model, gravity darkening and wind darkening. The reflection and the lifetime variation isn't in our code, but I think reflection won't be in the GPU code because we have to calculate it on the CPU because it won't be effective in the GPU code, and we have to mix with it, I think. And in the inverse problem, we use the Markov chain Monte Carlo method. It is now working for radial velocity curves, but it can be easily used for light curves also. So I would like to thank my colleagues and the rest of the Research Center for Physics allowing to us to use the GPU labor and get these results. Thank you for attention.
Why do you think that reflection is really should be back on the CPU? Because you have all the cells that you need to compute, and you in the most naive way you just compare every cell with every other cell.
Yes, at first
it seems to be a massively parallel.
Yeah, I think I tried the accuracy method or. I use two dimensional blocks from the all of the cell of one star and all of the cell of the second star, and I looking which cell eclipses the other cell. I have to compare each cell from each star, and it gives maybe the method or the fact I used was wrong, but it. With this method or calculation, took the calculation GPU longer than on the CPU. I don't know why. So for that I calculated the former star that are closer to us, the horizon of the star. So I have a for fully series an equation for the horizon, and it could be much more easily calculated eclipses. So so the code will be faster. Maybe it could be done the former mode, but my algorithm was wrong.
Or maybe the data locality is another question.
Yes.
Okay. Any questions? Okay, let's thank the algorithm.